gonna go. Do 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 do. That's a different song. I'm just, stalling for a little bit, giving the computer time to start churning, to let the little mice start running. Hi, everybody. My name is Evita, and I'm streaming to you from syncopatedcity.com. This is the Syncopated City YouTube channel and potentially the Syncopated City Facebook page. You might even be watching this from the Michael and Evita Facebook page. So many possibilities. I'm really excited. Today is April 4th, Saturday, and it is 1 p.m. in New York City, and we are still, thank God, healthy and safe. And as many of us, of course, have been doing, we're trying to keep ourselves busy, stay positive, stay inspired, stay healthy. So I'm doing this really exciting session today with Eyal Vilner. He's a dear friend of mine. He's currently based with his partner Ronnie in Paris. Eyal is a phenomenal musician. He's a saxophone jazz player. He also is a composer. He has a big band here in New York, and he plays in all sorts of bands. And I wanted to do a session with him today where mostly I asked him what can we as dancers learn from the musician's growth process or their exercises? And we're going to primarily talk about transcription or transcribing solos. So, without further ado, let's give him a call and see if we can see if we can find where Eyal is. This will also give you guys some time to say hello and get into the system and say, how you doing? What's going on? All righty then. So, Eyal, we're gonna give him a call. Hi, everybody. People are starting to call in and say, how's it going? All right. This is my favorite, the Skype song.
Hey, Evita.
Hi, Eyal. Let's take a minute and make sure that we got video happening here. I think we do. Let's see. I'll see you in just a few minutes. Can you hear me okay?
I can hear you just fine.
All right. I'm waiting to get a video from you.
Oh, no video yet? What's
Not
that?
yet, but that's okay. You're just keeping us waiting.
You should see a video. I see my video.
Oh, well, let's see here. I see you too, but we're just not having it pop up on the screen here. Hi,
Like
everybody.
off and on.
Yeah, that's a good idea. We'll try that. Nope. Hey, y'all, I see you. And everybody else sees you too.
Yay, are we live yet?
We're
We
live,
are.
we're live. I gave just a little mini introduction to everybody, sort of a welcoming them in and explaining what was going on. But I wanted to ask you, how are you doing? Tell us about your situation right now in the world.
Well, in the world, I'm in Paris. And the situation is tricky, like everywhere, pretty much. Me and I've been home, kind of self-quarantined since my Israel tour got canceled in halfway through, which was a month ago, minus a couple of days. So we've been self-quarantined for almost a month. And the lockdown in Paris started about 3 weeks ago, or 2.5, 3 weeks, something like that. Yeah. We're
What are
both
you?
fine and healthy, which is a lot. But we're sad about the things that are said around the world and worried and stuff like that. Now I'm trying to stay optimistic.
Yeah, of course. What are you, is there anything that you guys are doing at home to stay happy? Are you playing a lot of music? Are you writing music? What are you doing?
I think the first week was kind of rough. I don't think I was able to focus on almost anything. I was kind of playing catch with a lot of, news and stuff like that, and just finishing a tour, especially when it's not, hasn't completed. It's just weird because you kind of come with all this energy and adrenaline of like, performing every night, and with like it was big theaters and stuff like that, and just to have it cut in the middle was disorienting a little bit. The second week was better, and then it's kind of day to day. Some days are really good. I'm able to write and to practice at least three instruments and feel like I've been doing some stuff. And some days are complete disasters. So yeah, it's day to day.
I totally understand. I get it. So Eyal, that's a lot of work that you've lost. I mean, as a live musician that works for swing bands and playing gigs, that's been hard. I mean, I know that's been hard for our entire Lindy Hop community. I want to take a moment right now to let everybody know that so this is a streaming live stream project that Syncopated City is doing that Michael Jagger, myself, and my husband Simon were putting together. And the main purpose of this live stream is to collect any donations that anybody feels comfortable with and send them to Eyal directly, not through us, not through anybody else, like straight to Eyal. And I understand that it must be very difficult for a lot of people right now to feel safe with their money, and that's totally understandable. But if anybody wants to maybe send $5 or $15 or $20 or whatever you feel comfortable with, it would be great because artists that were surviving off of live gigs are really hurting right now. And really quickly, I'm going to show everybody this screen. I hope everybody can see that successfully. So there's Eyal. Look at that handsome guy, super handsome. And we just want to let everybody see that down there you can send to either PayPal or Venmo, and that would be really amazing if anybody could or would be able to send some money. All right, so I'm gonna flip us back over, hopefully, if my little computer lets me flip back over. Come on, little computer. Well, I'm still talking, and oh, there we go. Yeah. Also, some people are commenting saying, hello, hello. Lindsay Michael says, hello. Yes, tip the band. That's right, everybody. That's what we used to always do, and that's really important to do. All right. So, Eyal, tell me a little bit about what does a musician do to improve? What does a musician do to get better? Literally, just how do you grow as a musician?
Well, it's a deep question. and it has many levels to it. I mean, being a musician is technically, it has technical aspects like, learning your instrument and how to produce a sound and how to produce a sound that you're happy with, and get your technique going, which is, it's some technical work supposedly. It's like lifting weights or whatever, or working on your flexibility. And then other aspects is really learning the type of music that you want to be playing. So for me, I grew up in Tel Aviv in Israel, which was very far from the jazz world or the place jazz was developed or created. And I'll make it a shorter story, but at some point when I discovered jazz and and I fell in love with this music, I really treated it as learning a language, or learning an art form that has specific aesthetics to it, that has a specific rhythm to it, that has a specific almost like a dialect or aesthetics to it, and you want to get familiar with this vocabulary and with the way it's being pronounced. As somebody who's not a native a English speaker, that's kind of almost kind of like the same thing, and the best way to learn a language is to, to hear it, to listen to it, and to try and speak it. So, for me, transcribing was a not just for me, of course, but transcribing is a big aspect of it. And transcribing for musicians is to listen to a recording and to learn it by ear. In a way, it's kind of the equivalent in my mind to, a baby that listened to his or her mom or dad and, imitates that and learn, a baby in this particular country would get this particular accent versus somebody who grew up in a different region. Would have vowels that you and I maybe not have, or something like that. So the transcribing process is really important and essential, and so good
So tell me,
in
with
that sense.
transcribing, especially for non-musicians out there, like literally transcribing would mean that you listen to a song, to a solo, to, a melody, and on paper or with your instrument, you write out every single note and you write out every single rhythm, and then you basically imitate or replicate that same melody. Is that right?
Right. I mean, there are different schools of thought for that. You could go ahead and write it down. You could also memorize it all. There are advantages and disadvantages to both. What I usually do, it depends what kind of mood I'm in and what I want to focus on working. But basically, I try to learn it by heart first, and then write it down almost as a writing exercise, without my horn or with it. But I think the advantage to doing it all by heart without putting it on the paper first is that there's a lot of things that you can't put on paper, cannot put on paper. And these are the magical stuff, that are beyond the letters or the notes, right? The feeling, the bending of the note, the way it's being pronounced, the phrasing, the emotion that it convey or that it produces or strives to achieve. All these kind of things are such small, tiny pieces of information or pieces of emotions that are not, it's not something that you can read. You can interpret it afterwards. This is why for me, when I try to learn a solo, meaning like in, for example, I mean, it could also be a tune, but when I try to transcribe a solo, I treat it as if, I take a private lesson with Lester Young or Coleman Hawkins or Charlie Parker or some whoever or Les or
That
really
is a
whoever.
ph
And
that's a
it's also another
phenomenal
challenge
way.
to. Oh, go ahead, sorry.
Oh no, I'm sorry. That's just a phenomenal, such a cool way of thinking about it, because we want so desperately to learn from people who are no longer here, and or you can't get a lesson with them. And that's a really great way of thinking about it. Do you have favorite artists that you have transcribed? Have you done a lot of transcriptions?
I have, honestly, I haven't done enough of it or too much of it in recent years. I think it's something that I did more when I was starting. And I do it occasionally, but probably not as much as I would like to. I did, however, do something this week. I just posted it actually on the Eyal Vilna Big Ben Facebook page. But basically it's a super famous and super great solo by Lester Basie Band from 1941, and it's called Pluto.
All right, so let's listen to that. And we're going to listen to a specific solo. We're not going to listen to the whole thing. We're just going to hear this one solo that Lester Young does. And you were telling me that this is a very young Lester Young. Is that true?
I can't remember when he was born, but it was 1941, so yes, it's
It's a young
younger than
one.
older.
Okay, let's try this out. Hold on, I'm going to change this over and let's take a listen. Here he comes, he's coming up. Thank you. my goodness.
Yes.
That is fabulous. Shall we listen to it one more time, or you want to tell us about it, or you want to tell us about your transcription of it?
I think that right. There are many different levels of learning that you can do from transcribing a solo. I'm halfway talking to dancers now, but not. I'll keep it more general for musicians. From the musician side, music. I was just talking about it in a kind of a lecture that I gave last week for one of the swing schools in Israel. I think, or when I'm thinking about it now, music has three or four main levels, let's say, or like aspects. It'll be like a melody, rhythm, or whether it's the rhythm of the phrasing that you're doing, or the beat, basically. Harmony, which is another level, that is not something. It is kind of a deeper level because it's a little harder to understand sometimes. You definitely feel it, but it's slightly more theoretical, so it's a little bit harder to explain sometimes. And the fourth one is kind of an extension, but it's basically language. Like if a song has lyrics, that's kind of another level of analyzing music or thinking of music or another aspect of music. Why did I get there? Because when you learn a solo, you can focus on any or all of these components. So you can look at the melody that he is playing. Also, when he is soloing, when Lester Young is soloing, he's improvising something, right? So he's composing something on the spot, but it's not like out of nowhere and without any context. It's not without any context because he is playing with the rhythm, right? He's playing with the band that's behind him or next to him, and he's playing over the form of the song. So if the song is ooh, over do dee da do 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 dee da do dee da dee do da over do dee da do do, so you can still hear if you're focusing on that theme melody or head melody, you can still hear it during his solo. And he's not necessarily referencing the original melody so much, but he does play his solo, his improvisation over the changes, over the chords, over the structure of the song. So one way of looking, for things I can learn from the solo is, how he's creating melodies, improvising melodies over a specific set of chords, for example, how he addresses the rhythm, his phrasing, which is something so special because, I could supposedly read that solo as an etude and learn how he constructed a melody over changes. I can analyze it. But what you can really learn, more than just the notes per se or the letters, is all of the little things, like which note he's emphasizing more, which note he's kind of like bending a little bit or turning a little bit. You hear a lot of basically how he tells a story. I mean, he starts
On that,
with one, two,
yeah.
three, four, da, which is almost kind of like an introduction. Sorry, are you saying something?
I think there was a little bit of a lag. I just got really excited when you said it's kind of like a conversation or like speech. If we get to it a little bit later, so in preparing for this session, Eyal gave me some homework, which was as a dancer to transcribe a solo. And it was really difficult. And I really appreciate you breaking down these kind of sections. There's melody, there's rhythm, there's harmony, there's language. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot more that we could look at. There's energy level, there's staccato or legato, there's high pitches, low pitches. I mean, and then what you said last was the story that's being told. And I think as humans, you don't need any dance training and you don't need any musical training to be able to connect with that and even replicate it. I know that we could keep talking about the technicalities of transcription, but I'm super eager, Eyal, to hear, have you transcribed this Lester Young solo?
Yes. Do you want me to play it for you? I can attempt to do that.
It would be so exciting to just to have a listen to you.
Sure. Let's see. I'll try and play it from my computer and then play along with it. You'll probably hear a weird balance of me being a little louder or something like that, but it'll kind of give you hopefully a feel of how it works. You ready? Here we go. I'm happy to play for you. I'm not really going for interpretation yet. The reason is because when I mean, you'll hear it on an alto saxophone. Lester Young plays it on a tenor. So it's already different. It's going to be different fingering. A lot of the things that I'm doing are saxophone technical stuff. Like I'm trying to, because I play tenor as well, I know where it would sit on my fingers. And the saxophone is an interesting instrument. It sounds different. There's like, there's a way to play a D with a side key and a D with, seven fingers. And it would bend slightly different. So I'm doing some adjustments myself to match him. So I'm not giving interpretation yet, but I'm basically trying to be in his shoes as much as I can and to get as much aspects and levels from this piece and apply it to me.
I hear you. I hear you. I love that. Okay, so let's some people were saying that they can't hear me, and thanks for letting me know when you can and cannot. That's super helpful. I'm playing back and forth with the microphone to mute myself to make sure we hear AL. But thank you for the reminders in the chat. If you can't hear me, totally yell at me through the computer. Okay, so we're gonna listen to AL.
So far. Okay, so here is a solo. Let me give it a try. So he's playing a pickup of two bars, which is 1/8 count. So I'll count 5/6, 5/6, 7, and.
Beautiful. That was fantastic. Just getting to hear your tone and appreciate the work that you have done to transcribe this. It's great. My God. So,
I mean, thank you. But also, like, this is what we jazz musicians do. This is kind of like, this is our practice, or it's an essential part of our practice. This is like, it's not me being whatever. It's like this is our job to, this is how we can learn the tradition of this music and the roots of this music, and this is our opportunity to learn, how to be as authentic or where this music came from.
On that note, I want to jump for just a moment into a dancer's mind. And similarly, dancers oftentimes we copy moves, we copy other dancers as well. I just wanted to give everybody a simple example of, as a dancer, as a Lindy Hop dancer, what we might do in copying something. So I'm going to share the screen for just a minute here, and I'm actually going to take us to, this is on YouTube, so anybody and everybody can have a look at it. And this is volume one of the Spirit Moves, and we're going to focus here on Esther Washington. Let's see if I can make this screen large. Perhaps, perhaps not. I don't know. Maybe it'll let me, maybe it won't. Oh, there we go. It's just a little slow. That's all. That's okay. So I've turned down the volume, everybody, because unfortunately the music is not in sync with their dancing. And we might watch it a couple of times, but right here, this beautiful woman here, this is Esther Washington. And she is doing a jump Charleston, and this is kind of a section of the Big Apple. And I've slowed it down just a little bit for us to see, but I'm gonna take us back just a moment. So this is Rusty Dusty in the Big Apple. Yep. And then they're gonna do Spank the Baby as they go around. Now, everybody, we've probably seen the Big Apple, we know the Big Apple, and we've also probably are familiar with Jump Charleston. But if we take a look specifically at the way Esther does it, I'm interested in her arms, and I'm interested in the tap that she does with her left foot. And then I'm interested in this little shuffle step. So this is the break coming up here. Watch her, whoops, I went back too far, everybody, but hang with me. Watch her break. She almost looks as though after count eight, she's doing a shuffle. Eight, one, duck-a-doo, ba-doo, boo, and one. Yeah? So once again, everybody, you can look up The Spirit Moves, Volume 1, Chapter 3. Hold on, I'm gonna go back to you, AL. I'm gonna go back to so that we see what's going on here. Oh, we lost AL, but that's okay. Oh, there you are.
I went to watch the video that you're streaming
Oh.
and on Ronnie's phone.
Oh, gotcha. That makes total sense. So everybody, you can go to YouTube, you can look up The Spirit Moves Volume 1. This is the section with the trankey-do, with the California routine. We see Frankie in there, we see Willa Mae Ricker. And then there's this little section of the Big Apple, and you've got Pepsi Bethel, you've got Leon James, Al Mins, and you have Esther Washington and another woman that I'm embarrassed and I'm sad to say I don't know who. What her name is. But I'm interested in this Jump Charleston because I'm going to make the screen a little bit larger and focus on my picture for just a second. So, normally when I do a Jump Charleston or the way that I learned it, I would go, womp, ga, ba, a da, ba, da, boom, ga, ga, da, ga, da. And then when I would do the break, I would usually go eight, I would tap one, two, three, and I'd kind of fishtail out of it. But if I really, similar to the musician's exercise, if I really try to transcribe what Esther Washington is doing, a little bit of a difference is that she kicks forward one, two with a double hop, three, four, and then five, she goes with her left foot, tap, and then steps on it. So it looks like this. One, three, five, and tap. And tap, step. So I thought that was interesting and different from what I do. Another thing with her arms, normally when I do jump Charleston, I kind of swing both arms around like this and then both of my arms go up. But Esther Washington, she swings really across like this, kicks, and then here she does one arm at a time, almost like cactus arms, like this. So I thought that was really interesting, and I just wanted to point out that as dancers, In a way, we can also transcribe solos. We can watch somebody and we can pick out what their posture is, what their rhythm and timing is, where they choose to put their arms. And that might be a close way that we can do this exercise in a similar way that Eyal is saying he would transcribe a solo. Yeah. Oh, look at my hair. It's already fallen out. That's okay. So I just wanted to show that to everybody. Now, Eyal, you gave me some homework. Do you remember what your homework was for me?
Yes. Wait, but you didn't show the transcription that you did yet. You want to show it afterwards?
For Esther. Can I ask if anybody, when I jump around, was my microphone bopping too much? I'm worried about that. I don't want to jump and have the microphone jump around. Let's try this. Okay, so Al, you want to see my transcription then?
Yeah.
Okay, put me on the spot. All right. Okay. So Esther Washington, she's coming around. And then as she goes into her jump Charleston, she has Oh, I did it wrong. Eight da 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 So that's super different. Her break step, I would normally go 8 1 2 ha, fish. But Esther goes 8 8 1 a 2 a 3 5 7 and 1. She goes onto her right leg for that fish tail. I must have been either doing it wrong the whole time or I learned it differently. I'll show that whole thing one more time and I'll try to get the shuffle right. So a 5 6 7 8 1 3 tap kick kick da 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 eight dee ka da ka do 5 7 oh I did it wrong 8 dee ka da ka do and ha 8 1 a 2 a 3 4 5 7 1 yeah she goes the other way. Anyways, I'll continue to work on that one. I have to say, I spent more time trying to transcribe my homework that I got from Eyal. Which was, will you tell them about your recommendation for me, Eyal?
Yes, sorry, and this is kind of what I meant. Maybe I wasn't clear, but what I suggested to Evita was a solo that I transcribed by the great Louis Armstrong a while ago. I transcribed it a while ago, and it's something that I recommend to some of my students sometimes. And it's from a great album that he recorded with Duke Ellington. If I'm not mistaken, it's the only meeting, like recorded meeting, that they had, which is tragic when you think about it. But yeah, it's a great album. And Louis Armstrong always plays stuff that are so lyrical and so heartfelt, and so the phrasing is just uplifting and also very, very clear and melodic. It has a lot of space in it, and I think like it's a great exercise, a great example of a solo that's not too technical, not too hard to transcribe supposedly, but there's so much depth to it that you can learn from listening to it.
So on that note, we'll take a listen. This is called Duke's Place, 1990 remastered. You can find this anywhere. I'm using Spotify, and I'm gonna forward us to about 2 minutes in, where we hear Louis Armstrong's solo on the trumpet. Let me just check that my system audio is a go, and let's have a listen. I'm gonna forward us to 2 minutes.
In the swim, Duke's Place. Life is in the swim, Duke's Place.
Well, it's after this clarinet solo, and I'm having a hard time forwarding. I think my little computer is working really hard right now. So I'm just gonna let it play and not mess it up.
More for.
After this clarinet solo, we're going to hear Louis Armstrong come in, and this is the trumpet solo I was trying to transcribe. How beautiful is that, y'all? How beautiful is that? Okay, Eyal. So I'm gonna show you what I came up with, and then I would love your advice, especially because as a teacher, you have transcribed this, right?
Yes.
Okay. So I have to say I have an unfair advantage because my husband is a classical musician. And when I was listening to this with Simon and asking for his guidance or his help, or I mean, I was totally overthinking it in the beginning. I think oftentimes as dancers, we feel like we need to hit everything. And sometimes it's just really, really difficult for us to do that because, you know, because we're not musicians, we move the body. We're athletes, we're movers. And so I think it would almost be taking away from the art form of the body's movement if we tried to hit every single note the way that a musician can literally with their fingers hit every single note. So then I started to just think about the bigger sections. If I can just come in when he comes in and I can stop when he stops, I think that would be a big success. And then in the process of doing that, I realized that, of course, we're in a blues, and Louis Armstrong spans across two phrases of music, two blues phrases. So for dancers, we think of that as 12, 8 counts, 6 and 6. And then within each of these phrases, Louis kind of just gives us three conversational ideas. He kind of just, oh, New York City, I don't know if you can hear the siren or not, but in each of those two phrases, Louis kind of just gives us a do da do do boo dee do da do do ba do 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 da do 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 da 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 dee do do dee da do dee do da. I'm not singing the correct notes because I'm not trained in my pitch. But you know, there was kind of like these three ideas, and then over here it was these three ideas. And that really helped me when trying to figure out what to do. So I'll show you and I'll show everybody who's watching literally what my transcription was, and then I'll try to do it to music, and then we can talk about it. And I hope I don't mess up. I only like kind of solidified it this morning. So here we go. I hope you can see me and hear me. So the clarinet was going do-ga-da-do-ga-da-do-ga-da-do-ga-da-do-ga-da-do-ga-da-do-ga-da-do, and I'm waiting. And so is Louis, I'm sure. And so when the next phrase starts, nothing happens on 1, 2, 3, 4. And Louis comes in on count 5. So I'm going to go ba 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 da ba 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 ba, which was just kick, step, rock, step, And he stops on count 3 and nothing happens. So I'm just going to wait. Then the next thing that happens is on a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, ba da ba. So there's a little bit more length to this one. So I'm gonna go a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and ba da ba. And that ba da ba at the end, I decided to do the same rock step cross because it sounds like the end of the previous idea. I'm also choosing a kick, step, kick, and here I have a slide, not a slide, but just a little bit of a dragged out moment, because in Louis' trumpet, he kind of has ba-da-ba-da-ba-boop-ba-e-ba-da-ba. So I'm trying to hit that. And then the third idea in the first phrase, he starts on a pickup. It's like N8, 1, 2, 3, 4. So I'm just going to go into a Susie Q, and I'm going to use the heel to kind of give it and 8 to hit that rhythm. And 8, 1, 2, 3, 4. And there's a bit of a stop, so I'm going to freeze or hold it. And then I'm going to finish it off with a fall off the log, starting on 6. 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, Is that right? I think so. So that first part is 1, 2, 3. Ba da ba da ba 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 ba. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, se ba da ba. 8, 1, 2, 3, ba 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 boo do ah. And I stop. And again, Louis has a moment where he's just quiet. And then might as well finish this last part of the phrase. So then the second phrase comes around and it's another three ideas. So the first idea is actually starts on count 3. One, two. So I'm going to go slip slop. Three, five, seven, eight. Sis kaboom ba. Kind of like from the Big Apple. So slip slop, slip kick, triple step, rock step, and I hold and I dissolve into like a little hip roll on count one. And I wait again. And then he has one more sort of, how's it go? Ba boo ga ga ga. And then we finally finish with the third or the last idea. I'm just gonna pivot around and I'm gonna dissolve the end of this whole solo into a turn because Louis' trumpet just kind of goes sort of like that. So let me play it for you all one more time and then let me dance it for you. So maybe you can hear some of the stuff I was talking about. Oh, Nick says, hip roll, I see that. I know you do. I know you do. You know what? I'm afraid that the Spotify is going to be slow because of all the programs I have on my computer. So I'm just going to dance it this go-round and cross my fingers that I don't mess up. Yeah. And let me check to make sure that you guys hear the sound. Yes, y'all hear the sound.
Yeah, we can hear it.
Excellent. That was terrible. That was terrible. I scared myself. Starts on a three, doesn't it? That was a little bit better. Boy, that was hard.
Yeah.
That was hard. Anyways, I let me show everybody because this makes no sense. This makes no sense at all. Whoops. But that's kind of how I charted it out. You see my two phrases there? And then I've got rock step, kick step, slip slap. I should take a lesson with you, AL, in actually writing notation of rhythm. That might help me.
Yeah, we can do that.
And so anyways, it's not perfect. I don't think that's a finished, polished product. But what I did, first of all, everybody at home, I want you to know that that took me, I mean, I was listening to this solo from when we first started planning this AL, so it's been at least 4 days. It's been at least...
Which you had nothing else to do, right? You just did that for the whole 4 days, I'm
sure,
right?
Yeah. That's it. And I must have listened to that one little solo at least 50 times, at least, if not more. And like I said, after feeling overwhelmed by all the amazingness that Louis is doing, I had to simplify down into, okay, they're chunks. They're just big chunks. And then I had to figure out as a dancer... start moving and stop moving on this. I think if I had another week with this and that's all I was working on, I would go into depth in terms of, you know, levels, like something higher and lower. But what I'm mostly happy about is that I understand his solo and I understand the structure of it. And what I learned the most from Louis Armstrong and from this homework, AL, is that it's really phenomenal to just leave space. I mean, like, everyone has told me that before, and I've read it in books, and I've heard about how jazz musicians leave space for each other and for call and response.
Supposedly, though.
Supposedly.
Or they could.
Yeah, but
I think it's the same problem it depends what kind of style you like listening to and what's your philosophy about it. But yes, I do love space, and I think that it allows a breather and also a place for other band members to respond and stuff like that. And I think that, you know, when Gabby Cook and I started the jam that we do in New York, it was so interesting to see on both sides. Basically, the idea was to bring together musicians and dancers and to improvise together. And that's all, like, I talk a lot about it, so I'll leave that to whoever knows, and whoever don't, welcome to check it out. But basically, the idea is to bring together musicians and dancers and to improvise together and to exchange. And it seems like on both parties, people didn't space. And it was so interesting to notice that, and to work on leaving space with your own melody, choreography, and, you know, with space. Yeah, space.
Yeah, I mean, space. I notice within myself when I take solos and when I'm dancing, I feel the need to physically output nonstop. Just kick step, kick step, keep going, keep going, keep going. And I just don't need that. And I recognize when listening to a brilliant soloist like Louis Armstrong's example here, you enjoy it because there's a chance to hear and digest it. And coming back around, Eyal, to what you said earlier about conversation telling a story, sort of an emotional like expression of a solo, when I think about this one, it's like he says, "Hey, anybody here right now? Hey, anybody here, you want to come dance with me? No, well, that's fine. I'll just do it all myself." You know, like it sounds like he's calling out and saying something, literally. So anyways, yeah, that was my homework. And I'm gonna keep working on it actually, because as you said, it's just such a beautiful little chunk of melody material. Okay, Eyal. Any other suggestions as a musician that you would give to me or any dancer who was trying to transcribe a solo like what I just did?
The process could be different to each of you, but I think that there is advantage or things that you can get by mathematically, quote unquote, analyze it. Like what you did with, you know, the phrase starts on the fifth beat or the end of the five, like the five end or an early six, some dancers call it. These things can help you, like, imagine that you were a tap dancer and that every movement was heard and not just as a gesture. Like, you guys have this amazing art where, you know, you can move your body and express a lot of things with things that are not necessarily audible. But a lot of times, the dancers that show me that they really understand the difference between an eight or an end of eight, you know, or like, you know, whether it starts on the one or at the end of one, or, you know, where the triple step is really happening.
Yeah, I
Sometimes,
wanna.
again, it doesn't have to be like super matchy, like we said before, but, you know, when you feel it, when you own it, it's super powerful.
Yeah, I agree.
So
I think I was noticing within myself a weakness of accuracy in rhythm. And it's something because I've worked with I've been around Caleb Teicher so much, who's just a brilliant rhythmist tap dancer, started out as a drummer. I notice within myself a weakness in accurate rhythm. So, and maybe even it's an athletic weakness, which is, oh, I can't go that fast, or I can't attack the beat that fast. But that's definitely one approach, like you're saying, which is to truly hit everything exactly. And
yeah, and
another approach or
go ahead.
possibility.
Say it again. Sorry, there's a delay.
And so you were saying that that's kind of the mathematical exact approach, and then there's another possibility.
Well, I mean, you can look very close through a microscope to like where each note is happening or ending or where the shake is or the turn and stuff like that. And then you can zoom back a little bit and see the story, right? You were talking about the first phrase and the space that he left, and then the second phrase you said so beautifully is like, I mean, we call phrase like a sentence musicians call, like what you called a phrase, or two blues phrases, for us is two choruses.
Oh, I'm
rounds
sorry.
of song. It's just kind of like terminologies for musicians. But when I say the first phrase, or it's like the first, you know what I'm saying, right?
It's the first, so it's the first chorus, because technically Louis Armstrong's solo spans across two blues choruses. Is that the right way of saying it?
For musicians, yes.
Okay. Gotcha. Can I be super geeky for just a moment? And also shout out to my darling Simon for teaching me about this. As I was playing him that solo last night, he said, oh, it's got a phenomenal structure to it. This word sentential, have you ever heard that word before? Apparently,
no.
it's
mean?
I think it's a super geeky, maybe classical music term that Arnold Schoenberg kind of coined in the early 20th century. But it was something that was happening already in classical music. And it's, again, this idea of syntax or sentence structure within a composition or within a solo, that the solo is not just blah, 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 but that it's like blah, 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 blah.
Right, right. Yeah, Ronnie just translated it to me, so I understand it now.
Gotcha. So, Eyal, for sake of time, I mean, if anybody needs to leave in 1 hour, we love you and thank you for tuning in. But I think we should keep going, even if we go a little bit longer. Do you have to go anywhere? Is it okay?
No, it's just that at 8 o'clock, we'll stand up on the balconies and clap for the medical teams.
Yes.
But other than that, and you're welcome to do the same. Other than that, I'm yours.
Okay, great. So Eyal, I want to flip the roles now, because I gave you homework as well.
That's right.
And actually, it's not so much that I gave Eyal homework. Actually, like he said earlier, Eyal and Gabby Cook, they've been going back and forth here in New York City for a long time with these musical games that they invite everybody to play along with. And so, Eyal, you've already been very interested as a musician and as a composer in how you can watch dancers' choreography and transcribe as a musician what you see the dancers doing. Did I say that correctly?
Yeah.
Yeah, so let's maybe do a super duper simple exercise. I think all of us dancers at home, we know the shim sham, right? And so I'm gonna just show us all real quick. Our shim sham goes a 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 1, 2, 3. And the break is 8, 1, da, do, ba, ka, boom, ba, ba. Yeah, that's a very common thing that dancers do. And of course, Eyal has seen this, and this has been something.
I've danced it as well.
Yeah, and you've danced it as well. That's right, because you and Ronnie have been in class.
Closure. When I started dancing, I mean, at first I was able to study with a friend who traded lessons with Ronnie, and she taught us. Her name is Deborah. But when we got a little after that, we got serious about it, and we started taking lessons. Ronnie is my wife and I. And so, full disclosure, we started learning with Evita and Michael and Gabby and Nathan. I mean, for me, just kind of like a continuation. Yes, thank you. But also, you know, for me, learning the dance started because of the curiosity about it. And it made it, the idea was that, you know, if I understand what it is like to be on the other side and, you know, wearing the dancing shoes, would be to understand the music better. You know, it felt weird that I'm trying to play music for dancers while not dancing it or not understanding how it feels to dance to that music. Back when I started, I wasn't even planning on like being a musician that plays primarily or also for dancers. You know, I was a jazz musician, but I really felt like it'll help my phrasing and my playing and the feel of my music better, you know. So what was the question? Yes, I do know the shim-sham. I hope to a
So
certain
that's the
degree. I'm not
idea.
going to dance it with you, but
No,
I
but this is a super, super simple example of how Eyal as a musician is watching dancers and trying to, as a musician, reflect what he sees. And I'm not going to dance with Eyal because, unfortunately, if I try to dance and he plays, we will definitely be out of sync because of the lag. But we're going to listen. We're going to listen to Eyal.
Sure. So I'll try to do something super matchy and super like, translating kind of note to note or step to step. But if we are in tame what you do, right? So five, six, and something like that.
I'm making sure my sound is up. Eyal, that was perfect. That was perfect. Now, you have danced that, you've seen it done, and I think everybody at home, Eyal may not choose to play that while he's playing the shim-sham, but it's an exercise for him to practice seeing what he sees. Yeah? Okay, so Eyal, that was beautiful and absolutely wonderful. Your big homework was actually to take a portion from the Big Apple. Yes.
Yes.
Okay.
The part that we discussed is a part that usually when the chart is being played, when the music is played, is usually improvised. On my Big Ben's latest album, we recorded a version of the Big Apple where I wrote a version of it that is close to the original but also different, and the differences that I put in were inspired by the choreography. So while working on it, I watched it easily more than 100, 200 times, and then had about 5 hour talk with Nathan Bue, analyzing even more, and then watching it again for 50 more times. And it was a great exercise and a great artistic challenge, because I don't want it to sound like an exercise, and the tune itself is kind of simple. It's really two, three riffs, really. So to change the music in order to capture all the fun and interesting parts of the choreography, small or large, was interesting. So specifically, the part that you gave me as a homework is a part that was not written in the Big Ben chart, that I didn't write in the Big Ben chart, because it's improvised. Do you want to show it first, or what should we do?
Yes, I'm gonna share my screen and we're gonna watch. And we're gonna pause that for just a second. Pause, pause, pause. Oh, the computer is so excited. Okay, so we're gonna play this for you guys. This is basically, I'm gonna go back just a little. We're looking at their boogie backs into Applejack, Applejack, and then finally Gaze Afar. So let me make this big for y'all. Full in the screen, full screen, and here we go. Yeah.
Yeah, sorry to stop you. I'll take you guys to the window 1 second.
Oh.
Just so you know what's happening outside.
Oh my God. Oh my God. That's incredible. Ah.
That's it.
Eyal, that is so beautiful. Thank you for sharing that with us. Absolutely.
We
So it's
are trying to save lives by staying home, and they're actually saving lives outside. So.
absolutely. That is, thank you so much for sharing that. And that's 8 o'clock for you right now in Paris.
Yes.
Yeah, we do that here at 7 p.m. here in New York City. Oh, Eyal, thank you for sharing that.
Is it happening still? Like, I know
It
in
is.
Israel it didn't catch over
No,
here
no,
in
no, no, no.
Paris.
For the
People
past
are really into it.
for the
In
past two
New
nights, it's been a big deal the past couple of nights, all this week.
York.
Let me okay, so I'm going to share the screen now, and we're going to watch the portion of the Big Apple. We're looking at the Boogie Backs, Apple Jacks into the gaze afar, or yes, as someone wrote, gaze the fog. I think my sound is not happy with this. Hold on, let me try one more time to play that and let's see if we can get a better sound. Although sound is not really important, we're watching their dancing right now. Okay, I have a feeling that that came out very choppy.
For me, yes, it did. But I don't see the screen.
Just do it really quickly then as a dancer for you, and of course we can reference
Sure.
this on YouTube later, but this portion of the Big Apple, this is when the dancers are going boogie back, boogie back, boogie back, boogie back, applejack, that applejack, bop 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 bop, gaze afar or gaze into the fog. Yeah, one more time, we all know that, everybody, starting with a clap on count eight. A five, six, seven, eight, a one, two, a three, four, a five, six, a seven, eight, a one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, a one, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, gi-ga-da-do-ba. Yes? So,
Yeah, exactly.
that's exactly. So, this is choreography that Eyal has been watching, and as a musician, you wanted to transcribe that. Is that correct?
Yes. So, as far as the rhythm, I can attempt to sing it or to play it. And then the challenge is also to make something musical out of it. So there are, other levels to how you want to address it. But basically, I can show you, like I said, when I transcribe music, I usually try to first learn it by heart and then write it. But here I wrote it, so I can show you how like my sketch would look. Tell me if you can see it. Maybe you want to put me on a fuller screen. I
I'm
don't know
gonna
if
give
I
you the
am.
full, yeah, there's the full screen. We got you on full screen. Oh,
So
that's for
me,
real.
if I had to notate it. We're starting over here. I don't know if it's mirrored or not, but this is left to right. And I put with an X the clap, basically. So it's going to be we count until four because why count till eight? So we would say one, two, a one, two, three, four, and one, two, and three, four, and one, two, and three, four, and one, two, three, four, one, two, three, up.
Da
One,
da.
two, three, four, one, two, three, pa, puda, ah.
Yes,
Is
that
it
is
right?
ex that's exactly right, Al. And I think I do need to take a class with you or take some lessons because I think that's a lot better. I think that's a lot better than my notes.
In general, I feel, and it's not a must for everybody, of course, but I don't know. I would encourage, that's cool as well, Evita, but I think that, dancers who want to deepen their understanding on music, might as well take a music class. But no, really, because I feel like, there is a lot of stuff of the art of dance as, as it stands by itself, but also like to, like for me, I felt like I need or I want, I'm curious about the dance world in order to influence my music. This is why I started taking lessons. So just as a suggestion, I feel like people could gain a lot by doing that.
Absolutely, Al. I agree. Okay, so are you gonna sh you're gonna play for us your transcription of boogie back, boogie back, boogie
Sure.
back, boogie back, applejack,
So
da.
let's see, I'll give it a try. If I
All
do
right.
something super simple with just Harmonically speaking, it's the bridge of the tune. It's almost like a rhythm changes and the chords go a specific way. So for the musicians tuning in, it's D7 for two bars, G7 for two bars, C7 for two bars, and F7 with that break. Let's see, I'll kind of just play the roots of the chords. And maybe do something slightly different for the claps. I'll just try and do something and hope it comes out nice. So let's do five, six. I'll give you a whole five, six, five, six. Ten. Oh, can you close the microphone? Because I hear myself an echo. Yeah, that's better. Thanks. So, five, six, five, six. Something like that.
Hey, y'all, that was fantastic. That was fantastic. Can you play it one more time? And those of us who are at home, dance along with him, starting with on count eight, your boogie back, boogie back. Yes.
Yeah, so the eight is the clap, right? It's gonna be five, six, seven, oompa-da,
Yes, that
right?
is correct. And will you give us a good long intro count?
Yeah. Five, six, a five, six,
That was
Yeah.
fantastic, Eyal. That was fantastic. I hope anybody who was at home, you were able to do that with us. That's cool. So Eyal, sort of some concluding remarks then. This whole session was about kind of translating how musicians work and think and grow, and how we as dancers can also improve ourselves. And boy, did I get a lot out of this. I mean, first of all, we all need to take a music class, or we have to have basic music theory. We have to listen to music a lot. And as you were saying, we
After the set.
what? Say again?
Was saying about the music class. Come talk to me after the set.
Well, and this is actually a really, this is exactly what I wanted to do, because somebody asked in the chats, can you recommend Eyal a beginner music class or a beginner jazz class? And I'm sure he can, but I want to make sure everybody, ladies and gentlemen, please, 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 if you can, if you have not done so already, we are collecting donations for Eyal right now. So of course, there he is. Look at him when he's got a suit on. And you can send money directly to Eyal, either through Venmo or through PayPal, because at the moment, Eyal has lost all of his gigs right now. And so this is kind of a way that we at Syncopated
4
City,
months at least.
yeah, 4 months, you said?
At
Wow.
least, yes.
So we're really trying right now.
I don't have a specific platform or something like that, but it's something that I've been asked a couple of times from in the past 2 weeks. So I might as well try and do something regular of that sort. But also, if you have, well, you can't go to a lesson right now, wherever you are, I hope. But yeah, musicality is about music, so try to expand your knowledge about music, whether it's taking private lessons or attending workshops and stuff like that. Yeah.
Oh, there we go. There we go. I think we can hear. Can't hear me. Now we can hear me. Okay, I'm sorry, everybody. Microphone flubs. But the point to all of that is that we very much we can contact Eyal. We can actually contact any musician friends that you have, and you can look for some beginner music classes. But again, I just want to say that this was really important because Eyal is a good friend of ours. We want to just reach out and help him out. And we are also going to be doing a session like this next Wednesday with Gabby Cook. Did you know that, Eyal?
All right, I'm going to attend.
Yeah, and the one with Gabby on Wednesday of this coming week, it's going to be at 3 p.m. New York City time for 1 hour. This is about how to take fabulous dance photos and make gorgeous pictures, or how to basically like take good dance photos. So it's going to be, I think, a super fun, entertaining session. We're going to share video inspirations, photo inspirations, and banter back and forth. But again, stay posted because we're trying our best to do sessions with, like I said, our colleagues, our friends, musicians, people in the industry who are having a really hard time right now with all of the gigs that we've lost. Eyal,
Yes.
let me one more time audibly say the link because I think I was sharing the screen, but I don't know if people actually heard me say that they can send money to you
Oh.
via Venmo and PayPal. So you can actually have Venmo at Eyal-Vilner or PayPal eyal.jazz@gmail.
Thanks.
Eyal, do you have any last final thoughts or words of advice for dancers and musicians trying to transcribe, grow, learn, do stuff?
I don't know. I mean, I think that kind of a summary of what we were talking about, we talked a lot about the technicalities of it. The analytic part of the transcription. Which for a student at any level, for any performer who appreciate themselves, they know that they are still dance, still students, no matter how great they are. So it's always good to know more and think more and analyze more and be super particular. But on the other hand, let's not forget the other side of the music or the dance, which is the bigger picture. The emotional side, the storytelling side, stuff that even if I missed a note or a beat or whatever, in the transcription or not in the transcription, I mean, I think that after the transcription is done, the idea is to take things out of it and facilitate it. And it could be something very brainy, like he starts on the five and ends on the end of three or whatever, something very technical, but it could also be, wow, look how much space he left us. Look how much, where was the peak of those two phrases, right? Two choruses of music. How basically as much as you could squeeze out of it and learn it. 'Cause like I said before, it's like taking a lesson with Lester Young or with Louis Armstrong. They're not here to, to physically feed us this. You gotta reach out to get it, and it's also a way for the music to be a little bit more hard to get and more like it's not for everybody. It's for like you can see when somebody did their homework. You can see when somebody really, it's not like a chip you could like put in and oh now I know Louis Armstrong. It's like you gotta really work and pay your dues for that. And the more you can think about and feel and analyze about, each solo, I think the deeper your art will be, whether it's music or dance.
Al, that was beautifully put. And yes, I think the thing that's most important is you got to do your homework. But
And it's fun
it
homework too.
shows. No, it shows. Al, thank you so much for your time, for prepping this for me, for sharing your experience. Big shout out again, and thank you and all the work that you've done with Gabby Cook here in New York City, doing the jam, which has just been a transformative learning environment for all of us dancers here. Again, if anybody is willing and has a little bit of money to spare to throw in your direction directly to you, that would be great.
They
And
can also check the album if they don't have it. We released Swing Out last July, and it's available on my website, eyalfilner.com, and there's three other albums as well. Swing Out is the one that's focused on Lindy Hop and swing dancing.
That would probably be the most enjoyable way of supporting you.
You can do that.
thank yeah, thank you, Ayal. We can do that. So,
Great. Thank
Ayal,
you so much. It was such a pleasure. Hang in there in
yes.
New York. Big hugs from Paris, and to everyone out there, we'll make it through.
Yeah, we're gonna get through this, and stay tuned, everybody. We're gonna do more of these. Thank you, Ayal. Stay
Thank you.
well. Bye.
Bye-bye.
And dee da dee da dee.